phone at no extra cost in 60 destinations.
So right now I'm joined by an absolute legend, Mark Hamill. How are you, bro?
I'm doing great, thanks, Ricky.
I'm so excited. I mean, like, you're Luke Skywalker. It's like, it's one of the best days of my life.
I know.
So I've actually met you once before. I met you at a premiere. Yeah, yeah. You came over, you said hello, you gave me a picture. So yeah, we're like that. We should be like that.
All right, yeah, we're best buds.
All right, so listen, I saw the movie on Monday.
Yeah.
I've got to say, it blew me away. It was a really, really good film. I mean, the action was amazing. The plot twists were really, really good as well. And you're in it from start to finish, pretty much, right? Which is always a good thing. Right.
Well, after The Force Awakens, people were, imagine how I felt, because I'm reading this thing, everybody's talking about me all through the movie, and then I get to my part and I turn the page and it says the end.
Yeah. That was one of the most frustrating things for me, because I was like, say something, use the Force, grab the lightsaber,
sure,
do anything.
Something. I know, it's shameless how we tantalize the audience, because there, even before my time, there were things called like Flash Gordon, and you'd see a chapter each week, and you know, something, the hero's car would go off the cliff and they'd freeze frame and say, next week, you know. And then, of course, you go back next week and they insert a shot of the good guys jumping out of the car before it went.
Yes.
So they cheated a lot.
Yes.
And those were called cliffhangers. What I loved about Force Awakens, that it was a cliffhanger literally on a cliff. I love the visual pun of that. So I hope it was intended. I'm sure it was. JJ's got a great sense of humor.
So The Last Jedi, how was it being like back on set and just being back in the thick of it?
Well, I mean, the responsibilities of having to do more than rotate and remove a hood were enormous. Because, you know, after 2 years of anticipation, I better, you know, put up or shut up and do something interesting.
Yeah.
It certainly surprised me to hear Luke say it's time for the Jedi to end. I said, what?
Yeah.
Luke was the most optimistic, hopeful character. And
yes.
I had a real, you know, sort of a back and forth with Ryan. I said, Ryan, a Jedi doesn't give up.
I remember you saying that,
Jedi, if he does something wrong, he makes it right. You know, even if he's traumatized and goes away, he regroup within, well, I don't know, 6 months. But 20, 30 years? Oh, come on, that's a little bit over-indulgent in my view.
So when you were actually filming the movie, how much of the entire plot were you aware of? Were there no like things that they tried to keep like quite secret from you?
Oh, well, no, I don't know if they kept secrets from me. I mean, the basic idea...
Of course not, the royal
No, line. No, it's not that. I mean, but you want to keep the secrets from the audience. I've never understood spoilers, because I had two older sisters that would take delight in going up into my parents' bedroom and then coming down and telling me what I was getting for Christmas, which was so annoying, because, you know, you had to act surprised. I don't know why I just didn't call them out on it, but I hate spoilers. I've seen trailers where you think, I think I've seen the whole movie.
Yeah.
So to keep the surprises, it's much more interesting for the audience. And, you know, I have some experience with that, because I had to keep the Dad Vader secret
Empire Strikes
for
Back.
A year and a half. Yeah, it was terrible.
Was that how long you had to keep it for?
Yeah. And
you can level with me, Mark. Did you tell anyone, like your mom or your...
Because here's how it was put to me. Irvin Kershner was the director,
and
he pulled me aside. And by the way, there was a placeholder surprise, which is, you don't know the truth. Obi-Wan killed your father.
Of course.
And I go, no, it's just as you see it. And I thought that was a great twist. If Alec Guinness were the ultimate villain, Kershner says, I want to see you after shooting in your dressing room, which is scary, because you, you know, oh no, what did I do wrong? So he comes to my dressing room and he said, I'm going to tell you something. George Lucas knows, I know, and when I tell you, you'll know. So if it leaks, we'll know it was you.
It was you.
So the pressure, are you kidding me? I was terrified, you know, of, I mean, I talk in my sleep. What if I leaked it by asleep on somebody's couch? It's terrible. And this is before social media, so.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
Okay, so listen, after the most recent trailer, a lot of speculation online and just amongst fans and things like that, that Rey might possibly move to the dark side. She has a bit of a moment with Kylo Ren. We don't want a plot spoiler here, but I've got friends that that I work with on our show. They want to find out in real life, if you were a real Jedi, would you want to be on the light side or the dark side? Now, I know the answer, but just humor me right now.
Well, as an actor, like when I play the Joker, villains have so much fun.
So much fun.
Because they just bring chaos and they don't care about anybody but themselves.
And I've got to say, the Sith seem to have more fun things to play with. They've got like Force Lightning, they have better lightsabers. The Force Grip.
And there's that sort of tension, that romantic tension between Rey and my naughty nephew, Kylo. I call him Ben. I still think of him as Ben. So that's sort of, it's titillating because girls like the bad boys for some reason. Yeah. Why is that? You know, you mind your manners, you're courteous, and you're boring. You know, you skip school and you shoplift, and the girls go, "Ooh, he's cool." So we don't know what's going to happen.
I've got to ask you, who's your favorite character out of the whole Star Wars saga? If you had to choose, excluding yourself, excluding Luke Skywalker.
No, I wouldn't say myself anyway. When I read the script, I said, "Gee, Han Solo makes wisecracks. He's a womanizer. He's a gambler. He's everything I want to be."
Yeah.
But I would say the most unsung hero of the entire series is R2-D2. He's saved more people than anybody else.
You're right.
I mean, BB-8's now giving him a run for his money, but what I'm saying in terms of he didn't get a medal. Everyone says, "Oh, poor Wookiee didn't get a medal." Now, I agree. The Wookiee should have gotten a medal, but so should R2-D2. Yeah. It's droid and Wookiee discrimination. There's no question about it.
And lastly, we play a game, I play a game on our breakfast show. It's called the Ricky 10-Second Challenge.
Okay.
Now, basically, I give you a topic. Yeah. You have to name as many things in this topic as you possibly can within 10 seconds, okay?
Oh, wow.
Pressure's on. You up for it?
I'll try.
Okay, so my producer's over there. He's going to put 10 seconds on the clock.
Yeah.
In 10 seconds, you need to name I'm going to say 10. 10 Star Wars characters within 10 seconds. You ready?
Yeah.
All right, so Mark Hamill, your 10 seconds start now.
Obi-Wan, Luke, Han, Leia, Admiral Holdo, Finn, Poe, Rey, Snoke, a Porg.
10 seconds up.
Oh.
I think you got 11 in 10 seconds. That's great.
Get a no prize.
you do get a prize. Got a prize here for you.
I
there
do.
You've got a Stormtrooper Pez holder. There you go.
I hate to admit, when I became a Pez dispenser, I ran into Harrison's dressing room. I said, "Harrison, I'm a Pez dispenser." And he looked up and he said, "Whatever floats your boat." He's unimpressed with anything.
Listen,
but
Mark,
thank you, Ricky. I
so
will treasure
see,
this.
Thank you. The movie's
my
amazing.
Pleasure. Thanks.